Hello children, today we are going to study a period of transition. This is the first lesson in your history book for class 8. As the name suggests, period of transition. Transition means change. You know that history is divided into ancient, medieval and modern period. Now this, from ancient to modern, the changes which occur, these all we are going to study in this period of transition. Further, this, the beginning of the modern period, what all changes occurred, we are going to study basically over here. This modern period was not the same for all the countries there in the world. In Europe, it began in the 16th century, whereas in India, it was regarded from 18th century onwards. How do we get to know about these all facts? There are various sources, like primary and secondary sources, through which we get to know about these changes which occurred. The two sources are primary and secondary sources. Now, what is there in primary sources from which we get information? They are the original documents, like letters, government reports, autobiographies, speeches, and newsreels, and even more. Through this we got information and we could get to know about the changes which occurred. The other is the secondary sources, which was interpreted, which was made to understand by the historians. And these were available to us like reports, reviews, articles and even books. Through this also we gathered information. Now let's come to the modern Europe. This modern Europe, what is it basically, what changes occurred in Europe, what was the transformation in the 18th century basically we are going to study. In this, the main important aspects over here were Renaissance and Reformation. Renaissance basically is rebirth, and this change was between 14th to 17th century, and it began in Italy, then spread throughout the world. Renaissance was basically the cultural movement that span between 14th to 17th century. Now what did it try to aim? It tried to aim to revive classical glory, learning and culture of ancient Greece and Rome. And these Renaissance thinkers were called rationalists. They questioned. They did not blindly accept anything, whatever the church told them. They questioned the beliefs founded by the blind faith and superstition. People were asked to judge and accept things on the right note of reason. Some of the painters in this, the humans became the center of study during Renaissance. The true spirit of Renaissance was represented by the sculptors, writers, painters, scientists of this period like Michelangelo, William Shakespeare, Leonardo da Vinci, Nicholas Copernicus, Galileo Galilei, and similar. Next is the Reformation. What's this Reformation? Reformation is the new spirit of inquiry, and these oppose the practices of the Roman Catholic Church. That means they made you to think reasonably. They did not tell you to follow the church blindly. And in this way, the people, they tried to think, they tried to question. Under this, we had the voyages of discovery, new places which were to be discovered. So, during the early 15th century, most of the important trade route between Europe and Asia was an overland route that passed through Western Asia. Trade with Asia was very profitable and extremely important for the Europeans. So, they thought about discovering new areas and they had voyages of discovery, and the tremendous growth in geographical knowledge and the inventions of new scientific instruments gave a flip to explorations. Improved maps and instruments such as the quadrant, the astrolabe, the mariner's compass and the adjustable sails made sailing all seas safer. These all were done to get knowledge about new regions through voyages. The next phase what we are going to study is the Industrial Revolution. Industrial Revolution. Now this is an ever increasing volume of trade meant that more goods had to be produced and in a shorter time. And when more goods are to be produced in a shorter time, we require machines. And this, the domestic system of production under which the artisans collected raw materials from the merchants, made goods at home using his or her bare hands, was with some simple tools, they finished supply goods to the merchants, could not meet the growing demand of the market. So a factory system of production was introduced in the 18th century. The rich merchants set up factories, installed new invented machines, bought raw materials from the market and employed workers on wages, produced goods on machine. This complete system was known as the Industrial Revolution. Now, where did it begin? In England. Why England? Because there were certain advantages which they had in England. What were those advantages? Abundant supply of natural resources. In this country, there was abundant supply of natural resources, especially coal and iron, which is required to start an industry. There was stable government. So when the government is stable, the things move faster. The process of industrialization can take place faster. The abolition of serfdom in the 18th century, a large number of people became free, the slaves became free and they were free to work. The British government with its strong navy embarked on a political geographical expansion. They were also expanding. This led to rapid colonization, which enabled England to get cheap raw materials from the countries it colonized. An atmosphere of scientific inquiry and an improved transport system in the form of canals and roads helped England become the first industrialized nation. Major inventions. What were the major inventions? The textile industry was the first to be mechanized. Some instruments like spinning jenny, James Hargreaves made it, Richard Hartwig's water frame, Samuel Crompton's spinning mule, Edward Cartwright's power loom, John Kay's flying shuttle, and many other inventions increased the production of cloth. The improved steam engine by John Swart replaced water and horse power in many industries. What was the impact? Impact of this Industrial Revolution. This led to a sweeping change in Europe and elsewhere. There was rise of capitalism. Industrialization led to decline of feudalism in Europe. A new system arose in its place. It was a system in which the means of production were privately owned and operated for profit. It was called capitalism, where a single person owns property, earns money and becomes richer. That system, which was operated only for profit, was leading to capitalism. Now, new social classes developed in the society. One was that of the factory owners, who employed workers and paid them wages. The main aim of the factory owners was to make profit. The other was the workers who worked in the factory and received wages for their labor. And they were exploited a lot and lived in great hardship. With the industrialization, new towns and cities also developed. New machines were too big to fit into small people's homes. So factories were employed, built, where capitalists installed the machines. People working at home could not compete with the factory made goods. So they had to work in the factories. Growth of imperialism. With the growth of factories, the industrialized countries of Europe were faced with two crucial concerns. One was the need for cheap raw materials to manufacture the goods, and the other was to find markets for the finished goods. So next, what we are going to study is imperialism. What is it? It is the policy of extending political and economic control over a weak country by a powerful one. This phenomenon gained in the 19th century, largely due to the Industrial Revolution. What was the impact of it? The colonists, they exploited the colonies economically. The local industries of the colonized countries were practically destroyed. For example, the influx of cheap machine-made goods destroyed the indigenous textile industry of India. The colonies were treated as mere suppliers of raw materials. No effort was made to industrialize the colonies. Agriculture too was modified to suit the requirements of the imperialist countries. In some colonies, only one or two crops were grown. For example, Cuba was reduced to only sugar producing country. In India too, only cash crops, which fetched high price in the market, were encouraged. India suffered the evils of British imperialism for many centuries. We come to the end of this lesson, and I hope you got some idea about this lesson. While reading the lesson, you can gather the information in detail. This was a short summary to the lesson. I hope you have understood. With this, we come to the end of this lesson. Thank you.